Tonight, the mother of the island's latest homicide victim comes face to face with the man accused of killing him. The health minister says stigma and discrimination remain major hurdles in the fight against HIV and AIDS. The CSA and customs officers consider their legal options as fears over job security mount if government's plans for new border control entity materialize. And frustrated parents call for serious thought to be given to the use of electronic textbooks to avoid the annual hassle of finding printed texts. A very good evening to you. Welcome to the Wednesday edition of the DBS News World. My name is Timothy Polio. Our top story. The mother of the island's latest homicide victim demands answers after coming face to face with her son's alleged killer. 18-year-old Glendon Barthelmy died after being stabbed on Tuesday afternoon near his home in Bacatel. DBS's Sheffield Gillard begins our news coverage.
Glenda Barthelmy is demanding answers after her 18-year-old son was stabbed to death on Tuesday. Glendon Barthelmy was allegedly stabbed multiple times by a young man known to him. According to reports, following the stabbing, the alleged assailant fled the scene but was later captured by police on board a bus heading to Soufre. The distraught mother says she sought to get some answers from the alleged perpetrator while at the police station on Tuesday.
He told me he and my son had no problem. So I say, you had no problem with my son, so why you kill him? You give him three stabs. He said, no, my lady, I only gave him one stab. I said, no, you gave him three stabs. Three, you gave him one to his left side of his heart. You gave him one to his arm. He started crying. He said, sorry, my lady, sorry. I said, no. I don't need your sorry for not bringing my son back to me.
Ms. Barthelmy recalls the last conversation she had with her son before leaving home on Tuesday.
I spoke to him yesterday morning. He was still in bed sleeping. And I called him. I said, Glendon. He said, yes, mommy. I say, I cleaned the whole house already. So when you get up, just have your breakfast. And then I'm going to do the job. But as soon as I'm done, I'm coming home. He told me, okay, mommy. I say, okay, bye-bye.
It is believed that the two were friends. However, the grieving mother noted that was far from the truth.
Oh, what my son was telling him, that's why I tell you already, I don't want to be your friend. I'm not your friend. So I tell him, if he tells you he's not your friend, he's just not your friend. You know? I'm telling you he's not your friend. He's like just so without you have a problem with you.
An autopsy was conducted on the body of 18-year-old Glendon Barthelmy, but the results have not been released. For the DBS News World, I am Sheffield Gillard.
The St. Lucia Civil Service Association and the Customs and Excise Department are considering their legal options when it comes to what they describe as the ill-conceived border control initiative by the government. The union says the new entity is not in the best interest of customs officers. The statement was made at a CSA press conference today. Prime Minister Alan Shastey announced his government's intention to establish a border control agency that would bring together customs and excise, marine police, immigration, and quarantine departments under one umbrella. This raised immediate concerns by the Customs Department about the future of its officers. Here is Don Nicholas with that story.
The CSA quoted from Cabinet Conclusion 247 of 2018, which specifically refers to the establishment of the St. Lucia Border Management Authority as a statutory board. This could result in customs officers having their current working agreements severed, which means they would have to be rehired. At a follow-up meeting held with the Customs and Excise Branch on August 28, 2018, members continued to express serious concerns about the proposed Border Management Authority. Not even a meeting with the Prime Minister was able to convince the association that the government is acting in good faith.
Our members have continued to oppose the idea of a statutory corporation because they believe that such a creation will be detrimental to their interest. Of course, you know, moving from the government service into a statutory corporation can either be done through secondment or through severing of your current arrangement and being rehired.
According to CSA officials, there have been contradictory statements made by the Prime Minister and other senior officials that add confusion in the minds of CSA members. The association further stated that there are no similar structures operating in any part of the region, and those other reform initiatives, including customs, have been strongly resisted in places like Trinidad and Tobago and Barbados.
The Prime Minister and his cabinet have created a cabinet conclusion number 247, which is the very first bullet point being the establishment of a statutory agency. And the Prime Minister continues to indicate both to the media and to the CSA, which is the bargaining agent for customs, that that decision has not been made. That kind of information is worrisome to the trade union movement, because we understand government to run merely by cabinet conclusion.
Government has promised to issue a statement on the matter. For the DBS News World, I am Don Nicholas.
Health Minister Senator Mary Isaac says there is still a lot of stigma and discrimination toward persons living with HIV and AIDS. The health minister says it has reached the point where persons with the condition do not want to access treatment.
St. Lucia may have made headway in getting persons with HIV and AIDS to live longer, more productive lives. Over the years, the Ministry of Health has organized many programs aimed at dispelling stigma and discrimination. But the problem remains.
We still have so much stigma attached to persons living with HIV, to the point where a lot of people do not even want to come out to be treated.
According to Ms. Isaac, many St. Lucians still believe that HIV is a death sentence, but the health minister says that's not so.
It is good that Seekers is here to educate at least the people who will be participating, you know, to educate them that it is not a death sentence.
Ms. Isaac spoke at the HIV/AIDS Summit here, which ends this Thursday. For the DBS News World, I am Don Nicholas.
As part of the ongoing review of the Community After School Program, or CASP, the Ministry of Equity, Social Justice, Empowerment, Youth Development, Sports, Culture and Local Government hosted a workshop geared at training facilitators on various ways of digitizing data for the efficient assessment of the CASP program. We hear more in this report.
Deputy Director for Research, Mr. Tommy Descott, welcomed this new initiative and stated that when this is done, data will be accessible in real time.
What we found is that we're trying to beef up the program in terms of trying to do impact evaluation of the program to see how well the interventions are actually impacting these kids. And one of the ways we're doing that is we are now trying to introduce technology into the whole assessment of the program. And so what we're now doing is automating all the forms, the intake forms and so on, which will provide us with timely data on the children participation rates and so forth, and then we can actually evaluate the program.
Assistant Director in the Department of Community Development and CASP Coordinator, Ms. Doreen Gustav, said that with less paper being used, the cost of running the program would be reduced.
It is paperless. It cuts costs. It is a program that has proven to be efficient, and on the recommendation of the research unit, we decided to go in that direction.
Digitization is the process of converting information into a digital format. In this format, information is organized into discrete units of data. Reporting from the Ministry of Equity, Social Justice, Empowerment, Youth Development, Sports, Culture and the Local Government, I am Chevre Marius.
Still in the first segment of the broadcast, Street Vibes.
Hi, I'm Alex Busquet, and you're watching Street Vibes. As we observe our current lifestyle, do you think we are helping the fight against the diabetes?
No, it's not.
Why you think it's not?
Because we're not eating the right kind of food. The right kind of things, we're not eating exactly the right kind of food.
So to avoid diabetes, you must eat right?
Yes, you must eat the right things.
Well, to avoid them kind of stuff, diabetes, you know, you just have to eat healthy. Avocado, bananas and stuff, and local juice, and you know, that's what I do to keep healthy. I'm keeping it, yeah, I'm living a healthy lifestyle.
No, in regards to the we eat fast food and those kind of things. Nah, too much fast food.
Bien mando, c'est si long, manière ou ka vivre, ou pas sa manger n'importe bagay. On est pour manger bagay qui a copié bon bagay ou ça m'a quand même été. Pas manger un chai sucre, pas manger un chai figmé, pas manger un chai mango. Dépend à sou tout bagay qui dou. Ou ça manger yo tout, mais pas manger un chai.
I don't think we're helping the fight because when we look at it, even the vegetables and whatever that they use, the different foods, they're still instilling those chemicals in it. So how we expect it to help us? Unless if we grow our things our own organically, that's basically it.
Well, there you have it. You've just been watching Street Vibes with me, Alex Buske, down here at the Aquarius Crossing, the intersection of Coral and St. Louis Streets. With that, we'll take you back to our studio.
Thank you very much, Alex. You're watching St. Lucia's television and news leader and listening to us on Rhythm FM 95.5. We are also online on the big screen at the Aquarius Crossing in downtown Castries. Still to come, frustrated parents call for serious thought to be given to the use of electronic textbooks to avoid the annual hassle of finding printed texts and rewarding students who excelled at this year's Common Entrance Examinations. Welcome back to the DBS News World. Frustrated parents want school books to be made available online as one way to ease their back-to-school financial burdens. The call comes as parents prepare for the opening of the new school year next Monday. Some are complaining of having difficulty finding the required textbooks. They spoke to Don Nicholas.
Why not put the books?
One parent took issue with the constant change of textbooks. This makes it impossible for older children to pass on their books to younger siblings. She also feels that with the proliferation of tablets, iPads, and laptop computers, the time has come to make the books available online.
Why not put the books as e-books online? Because everybody have tablets now.
Another parent is counting her blessings. Her child received a scholarship.
Because my daughter has a scholarship, so it was only my son, so it wasn't really a hassle.
Other parents have learned to accept the financial realities and plan accordingly. However, they are still encountering difficulties with the availability of the books at this late stage.
We have been told that the end of September we'll get some of the books. And I find that it's so late, you know. That means you should be, you know, doing something much different than how they are doing it now, you know. Because some of the parents, they want the books and then you just cannot get the books and there's the money finishing so fast in your hands.
I think what we have to do, what parents have to do is what they've always done. Make the necessary sacrifices and be examples for the children.
School reopens on Monday. For the DBS News World, I am Don Nicholas.
Last Saturday, the MP for Groseley, Leonard Spider Motoud, held a ceremony to honor committed community members who have contributed towards community development and students who excelled at the Common Entrance and CXC examinations. We hear more in this report.
The student awardees were Trey Philip from the Dame Perlet Primary School, Janelle Richardson from the Grand Riviere Primary School, Juanita Nathaniel from the Groseley Primary School, Amelia Rosemond from the Moshi Primary School, Cletus Adonis from the Groseley Secondary School, and the top common entrance achiever was Miss April Dagana from the Camille Rene Memorial School. According to the parliamentary representative, the initiative was well received and said that the new decision to recognize community heroes must be continued.
It is my hope and my intention that these awards become institutionalized and that we have annual awards for generations to come. We have a number of pioneers in this constituency. We have a number of people who have made great strides. We have a lot of people who have made contributions, very often unheralded, very often unrecognized, very often not even appreciated. It is time that we take some time off, not only to publicly make generalized comments about recognizing the stalwarts who have gone before us and the contributions that they have made, but to single out the people who, by and large, have been making their contribution quite quietly without any fanfare and without any recognition.
Community members were recognized for their contribution to community growth and development in the fields of sports, youth development, business, community service, arts and entertainment, politics, and long-standing community group service. The awardees received gold and silver medals designed by Mr. Thaddeus Montoot. The Lillette Award ceremony was held at the Golden Palm Hotel, Rodney B. From the Ministry of Equity, Social Justice, Empowerment, Development, Sports, Culture, and the local government, I am Chauvre Marius.
August 30th is observed annually as Fetla Wars, and the celebrations will take place in the community of Monrepo this year. 12 Lawas groups will participate in the festival. Last weekend, the groups participated in the traditional Lawas seance between the Baywalk and JQ malls at Rodney Bay, an event the CDF plans to make an annual one.
The Lawas festivities will take place in the community of Monrepo, and the director of events and production at the CDF is inviting the public to participate.
Lawas has been around for almost 100 years, and that is significant. It's survival, and it's a test to our spirit and our resilience, and this is something that should be celebrated. I believe that culture is dynamic and it's ever-changing, but there are some elements of it that remain the same. And for me, our traditional festivals and traditional things that we do, these things, they remain the same, and they provide the base for us to build and innovate. And sometimes I feel we don't have to really tamper with it, just allow it to grow and allow people to take what they need from it to create other things and innovate.
As the years go by, the Lawas fraternity has been struggling to keep the festival afloat, and in this regard, the CDF is calling on the general public to embrace it for what it is and not let the tradition fade away.
We have to understand also that we don't need people to validate us. We're always looking for validation, let's say from some international community to tell us what we have is good. We should recognize what we have is good and don't wait when we migrate from St. Lucia and we go and live in Brooklyn and suddenly we join the Brooklyn Lawas group because we realize that in a sea of millions of people, you have to be significant. And there's something about you that has to be unique.
The director of events and production at the CDF is calling for more youth to participate in the traditional activity. For the DBS News World, I am Alex Bousquet.
We continue the broadcast with Core Values.
This summer, the latest group of Peace Corps trainees arrived on the island, ready for months of intensive training in preparation for their service. Before being introduced to their local homestay families, we caught up with some of the trainees who expressed a variety of hopes and goals while living in a new community.
I am very excited to meet my host family and to hopefully become a part of their family. So, my first time when I was in the Peace Corps, I didn't connect as much as I wanted to in this. When I found out that I'm getting another host family here, that is as challenging as it is, that's a goal of mine, is to make more effort to become a part of their family and to throughout my entire year service here.
I'm honestly just excited to meet them. It's just been such a build up, and I just want to get in there, get to meet them, have some conversations, and to finally just know who they are and have them know who I am and start just sharing that exchange. So I'm excited to just eat the food. Obviously, it's always about the food. That's the biggest, easiest cultural exchange.
After an initial orientation, trainees were finally introduced to their new St. Lucian's families during a reveal ceremony in Babineau. Close to 40 trainees were placed with homestay families during this reveal ceremony, which included a word-matching activity to help break the ice. Trainees shared what new experiences they're looking forward to in the coming weeks.
I think just learning the culture, honestly, like the food and the language, and just really diving into kind of like their life story, their heritage a little bit more. I think that'd be really neat to kind of just know the, like, all around the cultural history and stuff. So
yeah, integration for me too, basically. Just like being here and learning, because I feel like that's a huge part of teaching, like just
knowing everything about the culture so I can better teach and like serve out my service. Yeah, so I'm very excited about that.
Congratulations and bienvenue à St.Lucia to all our new Peace Corps trainees, and a big merci tout moon to our St. Lucian homestay families for all your hard work and love. For Core Values, I'm Jamelyn Ebelacker.
The Tourism Authority throws its support behind a U.S. tour by Denry Segment artists. The details when we come back. The St. Lucia Tourism Authority, SLTA, has thrown its support behind the August 30th to October 10th promotional tour of the United States by a group of local artists. On Wednesday, that's today, of course, the SLTA presented the Denry Segment artists with branded polo shirts and a check for $10,000 to assist with their travel expenses. Sheffield Gillard was there.
Earlier this week, the artists participated in a two-day workshop that covered a wide variety of topics, including public speaking, stage performance and presence, professionalism, copyright and music publishing. The 13 local artists and one DJ will tour six U.S. states and will participate in the 2018 Labor Day Parade as well as Miami Carnival. SLTA officials are hoping to use the tour to promote the island.
They will be sharing and bringing their brand of music, their subgenre, the Denry Segment, to folks all over those areas. And I must tell you that over the last few months, every publication has been calling us for information on the Denry Segment.
Acting CEO of SLTA, Ms. Tiffany Howard, noted the positive feedback and reaction from the genre from visitors to the island.
Everyone is absolutely in love with the Denry Segment. From a PR perspective, this is a huge opportunity for St. Lucia. I mean, we have folks sending us videos. We're on YouTube with this, seeing all of the tourists that have come here, learn the songs, and go back and do things. We see the Denry Segment as cultural ambassadors for St. Lucia. That for us means that, you know, although we have representatives in all of our markets, the way that they're going to approach the market, the demographics that they're going to be able to reach with their music, we probably won't be able to do that with some of the marketing initiatives that we're doing.
One manager expressed his satisfaction with the level of support being given to the genre, which he says has been overlooked for quite some time.
We're looking forward to going out and being good ambassadors for St. Lucia. Denry Segment has come a very long way. These young men have worked extremely hard for a very long time, and they have now gotten the recognition that they truly deserve.
Digicel also provided the artist with two sets of branded shirts and polos for the tour. Additionally, the company will waiver all roaming charges incurred by the group for the duration of the tour, provide new handsets to members without Digicel phones, and also make a cash contribution of $2,000 to help cover any incidentals while in the U.S. For the DBS News World, I am Sheffield Gillard.
The Lifeline Center is preparing to conduct self-defense classes amid an increase in violent crimes here. The center announced its intention as it convened a health fair in Wilton's Yard, which included free health screening. Mental health is also a priority. The organization encourages persons to maintain good interpersonal relationships as they have a direct bearing on their physical well-being. Don Nicholas covered the activity.
Amid the spate of violent crimes, the Lifeline Center deems it necessary to hold self-defense classes for persons desirous of learning how to protect themselves or their families or even non-related victims against assailants. The organization has not decided on a commencement date, but it expects to do so shortly.
It is absolutely necessary for us to be able to defend ourselves in any situation, not necessarily us, but if there is something happening on the road, somebody, instead of using a knife or a gun, you will know how to just be defensive.
The announcement came as the center held a health fair at Wilton's Yard. The fair included testing for high blood pressure, as well as blood sugar and free massages. Healthcare professionals were on hand to provide advice on various medical conditions and healthy living.
How they can use natural medicines and natural things in order to have a better life. If you look across here, you'll notice we have some things that can be used, like the activated charcoal, how we can use cabbage, onions, tomatoes. Everything that the Lord has given us is out there. And if we know how to use them effectively, we can improve our lifespan and live healthier lives.
The Lifeline Center, located on Jeremy Street opposite the Civil Service Cooperative Credit Union, conducts basic health checks and offers counseling services and lifestyle consultations free of charge. For the DBS News World, I am Don Nicholas.
Sports is next when the DBS News World continues. Finally from us on the lighter side, a guest at the California hotel captured video of a non-paying guest, a squirrel, enjoying a slice of pizza by the poolside. The video shows the squirrel perched on a chair by the pool at a hotel in Manhattan Beach and munching away at a slice of pizza. The filmer said the squirrel found its meal in the trash. Hotel in Manhattan Beach at the pool. A squirrel dug a piece of pizza out of garbage and climbed onto a chair and ate it. The filmer wrote. Time now for the usual reminder. The mother of the island's latest homicide victim comes face to face with the man accused of killing him. The health minister says stigma and discrimination remain major hurdles in the fight against HIV and AIDS. The CSA and customs officers consider their legal options as fears over job security mount if government's plans for new border control entity materialize. And frustrated parents call for serious thought to be given to the use of electronic textbooks to avoid the annual hassle of finding printed texts. As a broadcast, thank you so much for watching and listening to the DBS News World. On behalf of the entire news team, I'm Timothy Foley. I'm wishing you a very good evening. Coming up at 8:30 tonight, right here on DBS Television, Newsmaker Live. See you in just a bit.